Hey, brothers and sisters, this is Brother Patrick here in the Philippines. Yes, I got a haircut. Got it trimmed down. It's summertime here. Starts in March. Anyway, got back from the ancestral place of my wife's family. Got the funeral finished up my father-in-law. They have, as I mentioned, if you've been watching my videos, they have a nine-day wake, which is just too much, you know, because people have to stay with the body through the whole process. At least, you know, they want to have at least one person there with them. That's why they call it a wake. I mean, that's what they used to do in the States way back in the day. And I assume they had it for several days in the U.S. too, before you had television, telephones, and or whatever technology to reach your relatives. I guess the tradition springs out of before technology. People would have to get the word out and have people time to travel to visit, you know, their relatives who died. So anyway, they still hold to that here in the Philippines of having a wake. And anyway, so we got that finished, thank the Lord. And had about 8 people get saved at the last night at the funeral home. I did a service at the graveside. No one came forward, but I was having an altar call, but I had them to meet me on the side, and of course in front of all the people, whatever, they didn't want to come over there. But you know, I used to be more about, you know, giving people a chance to come and talk to me without being seen. But the more I grow in the Lord, it's also true that if people are ashamed, you know, the Bible says not to be ashamed of the gospel of Jesus Christ. And the Lord said, if you're ashamed of me, I'll be ashamed of you. You know, if you deny me before men, I will deny you before our Father's in heaven and his angels. So, if people can't have enough guts and enough conviction of the Holy Spirit on their heart to come down in front of people to be prayed for to get saved, then, you know, I wonder, you know, that's a lot of times that's your, you know, your false converts. Now, it's not always true, but, you know, all of this seeker-friendly stuff has just gone too far. So I backed off on that a lot over the years as the Lord has led me to be more firm in standing for the holiness of the Lord and the righteousness of God. But anyway, brothers and sisters, I want to give you some updates. I'm going to make a video of teaching later on of some of the things the Lord's been showing me. But first, I just want to do the administrative stuff. We've got a few more weeks. People can send stuff to Sister Pearly. The address will be below this video. For people that want to send stuff to the Philippines, can send it to Sister Pearly up there near Chicago and just email her directly. I'll have her email address and stuff. You can contact her and then work it out. Sending it, we've got about 4 boxes worth. And also, like last time, there were people who donated. I think each box is like $85 or $90 or something. Great big giant box, no weight limit. It's just the size, you know, so it's much cheaper to send it through this bulk. It goes by ship. Takes about 2 months to get here. She'll be sending it before the end of April because school starts here at the beginning of June. So we're starting summertime now. School is over this month. The graduations and all that here are before the end of March. And it's really the summertime here, even though, you know, we're north of the equator and all that. But the hot, dry months are March, April, May. So that's really the hottest time of the year in the dry season here. So that's when the school is out. Anyway, so we get the boxes here before school starts, and that way we can give out the stuff for our kids to go back to school and things like that. School supplies, crayons, coloring books, all that. Any questions about that, you can ask Pearly. Any summer, children's summer clothes, or any summer clothes, even for adults, we can give them away to the poor people, the parents of the poor children, grandparents, or whatever. Please contact Sister Pearly. Also, on the Church of the Firstborn website, the link is below. We have the chat up and running. Brother Sid, who is doing the ministry side of the website, said that maybe people didn't want to sign up. But what we did is, on the chat, you have to sign up to do the chat. And that way, if someone gets on there and starts debating and arguing about the rapture and all that, hey, we can talk to them and say, hey, if you don't stop it, we'll remove you. So we can have a control over the chat. If we let anybody on there without signing up, you might have some atheists coming on there mocking people and cussing and blaspheming the Lord and all this, and we're not going to have it on the website. This is a place to build people up in the love of Christ and disciple people and be strengthened in the Lord, and not for a bunch of, you know, it's not the place for, you know, a debate about evolution or whatever people want to talk about. It's not the forum for that. Anyhow, also, we are looking for more prayer warriors. We have about, I think it's 8 or 10 strong prayer warriors right now. And I'm asking for more. If any more of you guys who are interested in being a prayer warrior, please message. If you go on the website, message there. It's Sydney at, I believe it's Sydney or Sid, Sydney at Church of the Firstborn. My brother Sydney is ministry pastor of the website. He's, you know, overseeing the prayer team, all the different teams. We have the new Christian ministry that's down there from Brother Darren in Dallas. We have the healing ministry from Brother Brian, OT4Jesus, down in Houston area. And there's some more. There's more. And I want to add more. So, as I mentioned before, if you feel led by the Lord and you're a mature Christian, you think the Lord is calling you to be involved in ministering to people, as an example, as I mentioned several times, if you've had an abortion and you've repented of that, you became a Christian or whatever, you repented of that season, and you feel the Lord would use you to minister to young women who are thinking of having an abortion or had an abortion, who need to be healed and delivered from that situation, you know, the Lord can use you, and the Lord would use you. So whatever you've been through, suppose you've been in jail, suppose you've been on drugs, whatever it is, the Lord wants to use you. You know, the Lord uses the things that we've overcome to help other people. You know, just like, I mean, even though I can, by the grace of God and by His Spirit, I could counsel, you know, battered women. You know, I even studied that in school, you know, counseling and all that as a pastor. But God would use a woman who's been a battered woman, who's been delivered from that, either by she had to end up leaving her husband to save her life, or the husband became a Christian and changed. And, you know, the Lord would use a woman who's been through that, who has now been delivered from that and healed from that, to help younger women in the same situation. So that's what we need, brothers and sisters. We need to expand the leadership. And I mean, that's what my purpose of the website is. One of the biggest goals of the website for me, brothers and sisters, is, you know, to disciple people, to make disciples of people. So being a disciple in most churches, it's all about, like, you know, the pastor, and then that's about it or whatever. But this is an opportunity for people who are Christians to serve, to minister to others. And by that way, you are being discipled in leadership, and, you know, at a higher level or a different level. And then you're also discipling people who are new Christians, or they've got trouble in a certain area, whether it be homosexuality, drugs, as I mentioned, abortion, whatever it is, abuse, all these kind of things that people deal with in the real world. And I get these questions every day. I guess lots of people just want to talk to me, and I'm available for you who are watching this video. If you're in that situation, you don't want to talk to somebody else. You want to talk, you want to message with me, that's also fine. I'm not saying you can't message me. I want to make sure I say that. I am here for you as a servant of the Lord. But the reason why, like as I said, there's, you know, women who have been through that who may be able to help you in different ways than I could as a man, you know, who has not been through, you know, that because I'm a man, who could, you know, help you in different ways than I could. And also it's an opportunity for the counselors to be discipled. And it also is growth for me in supervising and ministering and discipling people who are discipling others. So we all are blessed and grow in different ways, in different areas, at different levels, all through the church. And that's the purpose of the church, for all of us to grow and develop and become better at, you know, for me to become better at discipling those who disciple. That's the area where the Lord would grow me. So I ask you to join us. It's not about organized religion. It's about, you know, the church, just like a home church. And things like that. This is about the ministering to people and being discipled and fellowship and all that. It's not about some kind of a, you know, an organizational thing. But it's the living body of Christ, as the Bible says, that we're living stones, you know, in the temple of God. One more issue I will mention about here too, brothers and sisters, before I forget. The feeding programs that we've been doing, my father-in-law, that was his thing. Even though he was going around and visiting the whole operation, he's been helping me try to get everything lined up to put an orphanage in the other areas. There's two other areas on this island, at least as the Lord would lead. They're each about 3 or 4 hours from here in different directions. My father-in-law was helping me get lined up with pastors and the house mom and dad and the location and all that for the new orphanages. He's been scouting all that out and working to find the location and everything and coconut farms and property to build an orphanage and all that, and overseeing the feeding programs, he's been checking in on them, because I can't be but in one place at one time, and you just can't trust anybody. A lot of times people tell you what you want to hear. So my father-in-law, just like Jethro was to Moses, my father-in-law was, objectively going to these places and checking it out and then just telling me honestly what he thinks. Oh, this pastor is a jerk, or this pastor is not spending all the money on food. He's not handling the money right, or this pastor's doing a good job, or whatever. He would tell me the truth, and that's what I wanted to hear. And anyway, I went there to where some of the feedings are at. Some of the main ones that I usually show. Some of the feedings we do, I don't get photos from, because they're in the middle of nowhere where there's no electricity. And the pastors never even went to like the third or fourth grade. I don't even know hardly that they could operate the camera, much less, walk. Did you know that it's like a 12-hour walk from some of these places to a town that has an internet cafe? And that's crossing the same, there's a river. I've been to these places, of course, before. That's how we established the feedings and stuff. And you have to cross the river 54 times to get to this one place, and it takes 12 hours through the mountains. And it's the same river, but it just loops around and snakes around, and then the mountains in between are so tall, you can't really hardly walk over the top of each of those mountains, because in the top of those mountains, there's also wild monkeys and all kinds of animals and stuff that you might run into, but it's like a jungle, and a lot of it's private property and stuff too. So you have to kind of follow the trail. And the trail goes crossing the river 54 times to one of these places that I go to. The name of the place is called Manuel Peralta. It's one of the areas. And it's also in the rebel territory, the New People's Army, the communist rebels area. But the good thing is a lot of the pastors, the tribal pastors, are like their cousin is the commander of the New People's Liberation Army guerrilla group in that area. That they're all relatives. So if the pastor invites me there, it's like his cousin is the head of those guerrillas. So, there's no problem. Thank the Lord, as long as you're not involved in politics. They're not going to give you a hard time if you're there trying to help people, and all that. That's great with them, too. A lot of this stuff that they do, a lot of those people are just in response to bad government, even though, of course, what they've been doing is also evil. But, they're trying to fight fire with fire. It's kind of like during the tribulation when it starts. There'll be those, there's the Alex Jones viewers who are Christians, and then there's the Alex Jones listeners who are, like against the man, and they're going to take on the man and be a militia group and all that kind of stuff. There's the militia people and then the Christian people. It's kind of like that. So that's the same thing you have in the Philippines, but much more extreme. Politics is very deadly in the Philippines. Very deadly. To be a reporter in the Philippines is the Philippines has like the highest murder rate for reporters of any country in the world. And so as long as you stay out of politics, you're fine. Anyway, brothers and sisters, our feeding programs are exploding, as they say. That's the words of the pastors. The growth, just as the Lord had given me the commission with Joshua's ministry, that a little child would lead them. And that if those of you have been watching my videos, since at least the beginning of Joshua's ministry, the Lord is fulfilling that now. And I knew in my heart when my father-in-law died that it's another road sign. It's another milestone. It's another mark in the road of the Lord fulfilling his ministry here before the rapture. And so when I went there and I went to these remote areas, to the ancestral land of my wife's family, that's where some of the feedings are, and I met with the people there, the pastors and stuff, and I discovered that the feeding we were doing is not enough. The boxes that we sent last time was not enough. Of course, I already knew that. And it's just the need. You know, that's why, in a way, I don't like to go. Because when I go, brothers and sisters, you guys aren't there. When I go, you know, the pastors are begging me, you know, there's just no end to the need, brothers and sisters. We've been able to do some, you know, and it's up to the Lord. But the need, you know, we need to buy new pots. You know, if you've seen the pictures, I would have asked you, lots of people don't want to be on Facebook. You can make an anonymous account on Facebook. Use a bogus name, whatever you want to do if you don't want to be on Facebook. Go to the link below here. That's the Joshua's Ministry group on Facebook and join. And I put lots of pictures there. Every week I try to put some pictures from the feeding. More than the orphanage, I put the feeding stuff. I know I haven't made a video report. You can go back on my YouTube channel right here and do a search and look. I probably got 10, 15, 20 videos of the feedings, the orphanage, and all that. Slideshows and reports and all that stuff. And the report is still the same. We've helped lots of people, but we need to help 100 times more. The story's all the same. I mean, the picture says 1,000 words, and the pictures are very effective and great for you to see what's going on here. And I'll make another slideshow. If you would go to the Facebook group, which the link is below, ask to join. As I said, make up an anonymous name on Facebook. If you don't want to be on Facebook and give your name, make up a name. And just have, you know, don't put a picture on there. And ask to join Joshua's Ministry. I will, you know, approve you, and you can look at all the pictures and lots of stuff on there. You can go to the website, joshuasministry.com. I usually just put the regular report on there and stuff. It's just basically redundant of what's the Facebook group. But we need to buy some new cooking pots. The cooking pots we have, these a black cast iron pots that we have. We need new ones. We need bigger ones. And then the old ones, I'm going to put it some new feeding programs. Some of the churches I'm working with, because they've had so many people coming in response to the feedings of Joshua's Ministry, that they're planting more churches in those areas where we've been doing the feeding. And I mean, that was the goal. Brothers and sisters, there's some of you that are really into the humanitarian humanism side of this, but our goal is not just to feed kids. Our goal is to spiritually feed people. You know, as they say, teach a man to fish and he'll fish for a lifetime. You know, give him a fish, he'll eat for today. Teach him to fish, he'll fish for a lifetime. So if people become Christians, then God's going to bless them, and then they'll have their own food. They'll stop getting drunk. You're talking about usually the men in the Philippines, like 90% drunk. Stop drinking. Become a Christian. Clean up their life. Get it through their thick head that they need to support their family better. You know, they'll work harder because the Spirit of God in their heart, they'll stop being so drunk and lazy and work harder and then have what they call social lift. When people become Christians in third world countries or anywhere in the world, they have what they call social lift. Their economic status goes up because they're being blessed by God, and they develop a better work ethic. They develop more sobriety. God gives them ideas on how to be a better fisherman, a better farmer, better businessman, whatever. God blesses them. And so their income goes up. Therefore, we don't have to keep feeding their kids. And then their kids, you know, they become a blessing so they can bless others. You know, and then the next thing you know, they're an elder in the church. They're a deacon in the church. And then they are donating and are cooking the food to serve other people's kids that are not Christians. You see what I mean? This is how it is. You know, it's you got to have the vision of what God's trying to do. God is trying to, you know, to get all of his sheep, not just deal with here feeding some soup to these kids today. It's the spiritual food. And that's the goal. That's what we're going for, brothers and sisters. And we're having success. We're having great success. You know, and the only thing that's limited us is, for me, of course, finances. Praise the Lord, we've had the money that we needed on time. We have not had to do without. I thank the Lord, we've had enough. God has provided enough for us to do all the things that the Lord has led me to do. He's provided. The thing that we need more, I ask you guys to pray, is more leadership. And I'm getting new pastors. I'm getting some new pastors in the feeding programs. So thank the Lord for that. I had a few pastors that were backslidden who've come back. As a matter of fact, there's this one young pastor, and he was single, and then he ended up getting a girl pregnant in the church, and then now they got married, and then he didn't want to come back to the ministry because he did that. And I was like, look, you guys already got married. You repented of it. You've already, you know, he sat out of the ministry for like 3 or 4 years. I was like, hey, you know, this, God's forgiven you if you repented. You know, who said you had to sit out on the sidelines for X amount of years? How many years do you think you need to put yourself in some kind of a timeout? You know, you repented of it. Let's move on. Let's get back to work. And so I've had several pastors in that situation. That's a pretty common situation. We send a young pastor, like from the Bible school, we send them out to a remote area in the middle of nowhere by themselves. First time away from home, they're like 18, 20 years old. And I mean, it's just natural. They're single. They have love interest. And then, you know, next thing you know, they fall into fornication. And then they don't, you know, everyone starts throwing stones at them and judging them. Hey, all of those guys, every one of them, they got married. They repented, and then the people are like, oh, we don't want him to be the pastor because he did that. The problem with lots of alleged Christians is they put themselves in the place of God, they judge people, and they're casting stones. They have the same problem in the Philippines as they do in the States. And I mean, that's where I come in, brothers and sisters. I'll go there and rebuke those people and just repeat to them the words that the Lord said. He who was without sin cast the first stone. People sin every day. When someone repents, as it says in 1 John 1:9, if we confess our sins, he is just and faithful to forgive us of our sins and cleanse us of all unrighteousness. That reminds me, just as I'm on that topic, you know, the biggest controversial videos I ever made was when I said that, you know, I made a video that said, divorced people, God wants to use you. You don't know how many vitriolic, self-appointed, as a matter of fact, the people that were having a fit about it, they're basically saying if you're divorced, it's unforgivable sin. And the very ones, did you know that almost 100% of the people that got mad were all Baptists who were once saved, always saved, greasy gracers? They're the very ones who are casting stones and saying that if you're divorced, you can't be forgiven for it, that it's an unforgivable sin. Now, what kind of mental gymnastics does it take to come up with such a contradictory mindset? And they're the first ones, and they're casting a stone, but yet they're greasy gracers and believe that people can go out here and live like the devil all their life after they said the sinner's prayer when they were 10 years old and go to heaven. Live like the devil all their life and go to heaven, but unless they were divorced. You can do anything but be divorced. The silliest bunch of foolishness I've ever seen. And this is just another tool of the devil, brothers and sisters, to mock the grace of God. You know that God loves for sinners to repent, and he loves to forgive the vilest of sinners. Just like that song, brothers and sisters, that I made the video on, that the Lord gave me the song before I went to do the funeral and all that. Praise the Lord. Praise the Lord. Let the people rejoice. Let the earth hear his voice. Praise the Lord. Praise the Lord. Let the people rejoice. You know, come to the Father through Jesus the Son and give him the glory for great things he has done, that he's done. Not you, but him. Give him the glory for what he's done. And it says even the vilest of sinners can be forgiven in that song, which, of course, it's true from the Bible. The vilest of sinners can be forgiven through the blood of Jesus, what he's done. God makes some vessels for honor and some for dishonor. Romans chapter 9. That's one of the teachings I want to do. And that's what I talked about down there at the funeral home. My father-in-law is, I don't know if I mentioned the video, I think I did, when he was a young man, he was the vilest of sinners when he was young. But he changed, he got saved, and he became a completely different person about 20 years ago, before I ever met him. Became a new creature in Christ. And if God can save him, God can save anybody. And that's the truth of people that knew him. Very vile, bad boy. And God saved him. I mean, I've been bad myself. I don't think that I was as bad as my father-in-law was when he was before he was a Christian. I don't think so. Maybe. I mean, God is the judge. But anyway, my father-in-law was a very bad sinner. And that's the message. There's lots of people there who have never been as bad in their actions as my father-in-law, but they're not saved. They're not forgiven. That's what I was telling them. The difference with my father-in-law is he repented. He was saved and he became a new creature. He changed by the blood of Jesus. Great things the Lord has done. Great things the Lord has done. God bless you guys. That's an update. I'm getting into some teaching. I need to do some teaching as the Lord has given me. Anyway, those are the updates. You guys to please go to the website. If you want to be involved with the prayer warriors, please email Brother Sid. If you want to do one of the categories of ministry, get with Brother Sid. The chat, like the chat was, the we had the old website and then we had to redo it with a different format, and the people liked it under the old format. I don't know, maybe people don't like the new format. I don't know. If you have any questions or comments about that, just email Brother Sid, and then he will get with Sister Elaine, who's setting up the website. Any corrections or improvements we can make in the website, please let us know. The boxes, you got to get your stuff in to Sister Pearly. The link is below. And we need to get more, we need to increase the budget for the feedings, and I need to get new pots. As you guys pray about that, I know the Lord will provide. The vehicle, well, we've just been doing the funeral and all that, and I asked all the ministry team, and everybody's been helping me with handling that, and I've been going around just getting an update on everything, and we haven't had time to buy the what they call this, they call it a bungo or bungo, whatever it is. It's a Korean truck. I think it's called a bungo, whatever it is. Anyway, we're going to be getting that here this month by the grace of God. We just got to go find it and pick it out, and I think we have enough money. If not, we're very close. And I know the Lord is providing. Those donations are coming in the process of coming through Brother Martin there in Australia and on their way here. And, of course, I'll keep you updated when we buy it. And I just want to thank all you guys. And like I said, I'm going to come back and do some teaching. The Lord's been showing me all kinds of really cool stuff, brothers and sisters. Way beyond my, the things that, as I mentioned the video I had the dream the other day, the things the Lord has shown me is way beyond my pay grade in the Lord now already. And He keeps showing me such high level stuff. I praise the Lord, you know, that He would choose anybody. And, you know, particularly, of course, He's talking to me, and I can only speak for myself. I thank the Lord that He would, you know, allow me to have these kind of understandings and revelation, because on my own, there's no way that I would ever have this, these ideas and stuff that the Lord has given me about the kingdom of the Antichrist, about the Lord's kingdom, all this stuff. It's just awesome, you know, as they say, nuggets of His wisdom. It's just awesome stuff, and I really praise the Lord for it. I mean, you know, I just keep asking the Lord for wisdom, but what wisdom He would give me, it's not my idea, you know, what it would be. I just ask Him for wisdom about His kingdom, about the Word, about what He wants me to know and teach about, and then the Lord just gives it to me. And that's all you have to do, you know, is keep asking the Lord for wisdom. Keep seeking His face and just say, Lord, you know, fill me with Your wisdom, with Your love, with Your joy. Or, you know, some of you guys, you have different calling. It's not, everybody's got a different calling, you know. Maybe yours is, you know, whatever you lack, ask the Lord for that. And look at the fruit of the Spirit as an example. Galatians chapter 5, like verse 22 and 23, so you want more love. Lord, let me have Your heart. Let me have Your love for the lost. Things like that. Lord, let me have Your joy. Let me be filled with Your joy, Lord. Not the normal human joy, but supernatural. The fruit of the Spirit is supernatural. It's not your natural. That's why these old greasy gracers, these old denominational people, they think that the gifts of the Spirit and the fruit of the Spirit is just something that they're natural born talent. We all have natural born talents in different areas. But supernatural fruit of the Spirit and supernatural gifts of the Spirit is a totally different thing. It's, in other words, if you're a jerk and then suddenly you're filled with the love of God and you love all these vile people and you go to them and you hug them and tell them Jesus loves them and all that, and it's like the opposite of your character, that's the fruit of the Spirit of love. Not your natural born personality or your natural born character. You know, that's the thing about it. When lots of people who have met me, some of the people who've met me, they say, well, you know, Brother Patrick, you're different in person than you are in your videos. And that's because, you know, when the Spirit of the Lord comes on me, it's not anymore I who speaks, but Christ within me. You know, it's the Spirit of the Lord and His love, His wisdom, His all those things, the fruit of the Spirit and the gifts of the Spirit and all that kind of stuff. It's the Lord, not me. And my natural flesh, I'm only a man. I'm only a human just like anybody else. You know, and I have my own faults. Even the Apostle Paul said he was the chief among sinners. So, you know, I'm just a human like anybody else. But I surrender and submit myself and offer myself as a living sacrifice, Romans chapter 12, to the Lord, you know, meet for the Master's use. Said, Lord, will you use me to bring glory to His name? And that's all I'm doing. I'm just surrendering my will to the Lord's will and say, Lord, here I am, use me, here I am, send me, Isaiah chapter 6. You know, who will go for us? And Isaiah said, here I am, Lord, send me. And that's all I'm trying to do, is just do the Lord's will. That's just that simple. And it's all up to him. It's up to the Lord. If the Lord wants to Joshua's ministry to grow, you know, he's going to make a way. He's going to use you guys, and then me, and then the prayer warriors, and people that would donate, and all that, bring it all together. He'll provide the pastors, local pastors, the house moms and dads, and all that stuff. The Lord will provide it all. That's what he wants to do. He's going to have to provide. I'm not going to build my kingdom, but the Lord's kingdom. So I'm just a vessel to help him bring forth his will in this place. And all of you guys too. That's all we can be. Whereas you get lots of these denominations, they're building their own kingdom. As that famous quote of the Chinese pastor that came to the States, you know, from the Chinese underground church, he said, wow, the American church has done a lot without God. You know, just imagine what they could do with God instead of doing it in their flesh. Anyway, brothers and sisters, I got to go. I keep saying that. I keep running on and on. You know how I am. Love you guys. I'm getting ready to do some little bit of studying here and come back with some more videos by the grace of God. God bless you guys.